You only get to know, because I've been on jury, sirs, you only get to know what they've done before when the judge is summing up on the case, and they lead you in either direction. They're not supposed to, but you get some judges that are rather biased or whatever, you know. But there's 12 ordinary working people in a room trying to come to a decision, and I feel that they probably feel terrible about it, but they've only can go on the charge that's being brought forward, and if it wasn't very stable, unfortunately they can't charge him for murder. And because the prosecution hasn't said manslaughter, they've had to let him go. They should have walked out, you know, too difficult, hung jury, and the prosecution should have done this. So the prosecution fell down here.
So they risked it all and they blew it?
Yeah, risked it all and they blew it.
Okie dokie, thanks for that, Petrina.
Okay, love, speak Ta-ra. Again, bye.
We've got next on this line is Colin. Good morning.
It's certainly is. Good morning.
Good morning, Colin.
I'm sorry, I've been absent.
It's okay.
I've been doing difficult duties early in the morning. I've not really been up to staying up at night.
That's no excuse, and you know it.
There are people
who have this show taped and sent to them at various parts of the country. Did you know that?
Well, it's their fault, isn't it?
One being a Mr. J. Major, apparently.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
And also the chief of MI5. And
I knew there was something wrong with him, but I couldn't put my finger on it.
That's it. That's why he always looks so miserable.
Yeah.
He tunes in every night to hear himself getting a right panning.
Well, I'm quite rightly so too. This is very complicated, isn't it?
I suppose it boils down to whether or not you have the right to defend yourself if you're attacked while doing something wrong.
Oh, well, from the comments of other people, I have, of course, addressed myself to this problem. What is reasonable force?
Well, now, that's the next bit, isn't it?
Right, well, I mean, I don't know, but I suppose, and I know that you're often wrong when you suppose and you assume, however, I do assume, if somebody comes at you with their hands, then I suppose reasonable force, it's quite likely that if you knock him out with your hand, then it's reasonable. If somebody comes at you with a hammer, and you've got a knife in your hand, I wouldn't necessarily assume that your first thought will be, I'll put this knife down somewhere safe, and I'll knock him out with my fist.
Not really, no.
I don't really think that sort of mechanism takes place. I don't know, but I don't think so.
Not when the person in question's yelling, if you want me, come up here, come on then, what are you going to do about it?
Yes, and then you approach that person with a hammer, so therefore it's perfectly clear to that person who's egged you on that you're obviously going to do something with a hammer.
That you've taken the bait?
Yes. Yeah, but then, are you really in your right mind if you confront somebody like that armed with a weapon, in the full knowledge that they have also got a weapon and that they're actually goading you into attacking them? Please, I don't say that the guy deserved to be killed. He certainly didn't. But I just can't help wondering exactly what his state was when he decided to go after this fellow with a hammer.
But suppose things had turned out differently and he just swiped him one with the hammer.
Yeah.
It'd be front page of the Sun, wouldn't it? You know, what a hero.
Yes, of course it would. Well, I mean, unfortunately, that's how fickle society is, I think.
Sorry, say that again.
That is how fickle...
Yes.
...society is.
Yes, most definitely.
And we get very emotional about things because we...
Is it a good or bad thing, though, to intervene like that?
Well, I mean, in his particular case, it's obviously a bad thing, isn't it? Because he's no longer here. So he couldn't possibly have been right to intervene.
So does that send a message through to everybody?
Well, it would certainly send a message through to me, yes.
Would you intervene?
I don't know, Ian. I mean, I don't think any of us can honestly answer that unless we're confronted with a situation.
Because when I was confronted with a situation once, and my reaction totally and utterly amazed me.
Yeah.
Because I did the total opposite to what in the cold and rational light of day, if I sat down and thought about it, and somebody said to me, would you intervene? I did the total opposite. I'd have said, no, I wouldn't intervene.
Huh?
No, not my problem. But when it happened, I did.
Could I blind you with science momentarily?
Go on.
You brought a subject up before.
Fight or flight.
You mentioned the fight or flight mechanism. How did you know? How very clever of you. That is actually part of the autonomic nervous system.
Good old autonomic nervous system.
Now, I shall get no more technical than to say the clue is in the question, auto. Right.
Yes, the autonomic nervous system is the one that just sort of happily bimbles along without you having to do anything.
That's right, and all of a sudden, something scares you and you get this enormous dose of a very dangerous poison called adrenaline. That engages the fight or flight mechanism, over which you have no control whatsoever. You do one or the other quite automatically. You're an automatic pilot. You're not in control. Now, to me, if this guy's got a knife in his hand and somebody's going to attack him with a hammer, no matter what the circumstances might have been before, when his fight or flight mechanism has been engaged, momentarily he has had no physical control over his reaction. His reaction has been to stick him with a knife. Unfortunate, but I don't only believe, but I know that he did not have control over his action at that moment in time.
Because it is an automatic response.
Because it is automatic.
And I can absolutely validate that, because I did totally the opposite from what I would have expected to do.
What you rationally thought you would have done. But that is not what your mechanism dictates to you that you will do. And I can guarantee to you that you will always react that way when you get that dose of adrenaline from yourself.
Well, that's it. I'm not going out anywhere unless I'm blindfolded now.
Right. So, I suppose, really, what I'm saying is yes, justice was actually done. Unfortunate for the guy who's killed.
Because he was on automatic pilot.
Yeah, very briefly. And I know that a lot of people who've spoken tonight and a lot of people listening will be thinking, oh, do gooder and, you know, thinks he knows better. But sometimes, unfortunately, these things do actually happen. It's not an excuse, but it is actually a perfectly valid reason.
Well, I was going to say, you know, is an automatic response to a threatening situation necessarily a defence?
Well, I would believe so, yes. How? You can't control it, can you? If it's automatic, that in itself dictates that you are not under control.
But on that basis, everybody who committed a crime could claim diminished responsibility.
No, come on. Don't move the goalpost.
I'm not.
Diminished responsibility doesn't enter into it.
I'm just saying that if you go on automatic pilot, you can't just say, well, sorry, it wasn't me. I just leave him a sentence for a few moments. Well, you'll have to forgive me.
No, because look at the situation where some people have argued that if the fellow who had the hammer had killed the guy with the knife, then he probably would have been done for it. Well, I suppose logic really dictates that he should have been, because the guy who had the knife was premeditated in slashing car tyres. The fellow who had the hammer was premeditated in doing the fellow with the knife some physical damage.
Or was it simply protection against the knife?
Well, we'll never know, will we? Unfortunately. But from the fact that emerged, that appears to be the case.
So you reckon the jury were absolutely correct, then?
Well, yeah, because I suppose using a curious analogy, I mean, taking a hammer, you're offering to put your hand in the fire and you're going to expect to get burnt, aren't you? Well, unfortunately, the guy who's been killed...
If you take a hammer, you're up in the ante, you're up in the stakes.
Of course you are. And especially if you know that the guy who that you're taking it to is already armed with something as lethal as a knife. So if you're going to put your hand in the fire, you're going to expect to be burnt, and I think that that's all the jury have said in this case, is the guy who's been killed obviously isn't here to sort of make decisions in that direction, but we in his place will say, I'm sorry mate, you put your hand in the fire and unfortunately you got badly burnt.
Okie dokie, so you can see the logic behind it?
Yeah, I can, yes. Unfortunate, but yeah, I can.
Unfortunately, you see the logic behind it, and unfortunately, you agree with that logic.
Yeah. I think it's sad that somebody died as a result. But I can agree with the logic that it determines the guy who did it is actually free.
Okie dokie. And you blame the autonomic nervous system upon which you have no control?
I think that's certainly a factor, yes.
Yeah, because as I say, from my own experience, it does send you a bit loopy.
It does. You are not in control. Whoever you are, whatever you might be, whatever you might think you might do, when it happens to you, you're not going to be in control. You will either fight or you will run away. And no matter what you think now that you might do in that situation, you say, oh yeah, I'd fight, I'd do this, I'd do... You might not, you might run away, and afterwards you think, why did I do that?
And adrenaline's an amazing... I mean, an adrenaline burst.
It's lethal.
It's an amazing feeling.
It's lethal. I mean, the toxic shock you get from adrenaline is what you suffer from, like when you've had a car accident. you get a burst of adrenaline and they treat you in hospital for shock. And shock can actually kill you. What they're actually treating you for is your own body's poison, adrenaline.
I think we'll have to make you our medical correspondent.
I did study it for 2 years, actually.
Well, you can. This is it. You're our official medical correspondent. That's fair enough. You know more than I do.
Well, I've got to be officially something sooner or later.
That's fair enough. We'll make you our official medical correspondent on the grounds that you once owned an elastoplast.
Absolutely.
All right, mate.
All right.
See you soon.
Cheers.
Ta-ra. There we go. Interesting physiological explanation from Colin. He says that the guy wielding the knife had no choice because his autonomic nervous system decided for him what he was going to do, whether or not he was going to fight or whether or not he was going to run for it when he was put into a threatening situation. And Colin argued that it wasn't his fault. He was put in a threatening situation, and that once the guy had armed himself with whatever, he'd up the stakes. Who have we got next? We've got Len next. Len's been waiting the longest. He's next. Good morning.
Hello, mate.
Good morning, Len. Did you agree with Colin or not?
Oh, I just don't believe that guy. I don't believe him.
It's true what he says about the kicking. Once the autonomic nervous system kicks in.
There's a man died, you know? There's a man been killed. And that, I think it's a consensus of opinion tonight, and I'm going to toe the party line on this one, is that that guy should be behind bars. Yeah?
But then he was put in a threatening situation, and he reacted to it.
He's killed a man. He should be behind bars. I think where the mistake has been made, and I can't understand how, is surely when they go to court on a charge like this, as serious as this, surely they give them an alternative charge, and the judge directs the jury, after hearing the evidence, to either give it first-degree murder or second-degree murder or manslaughter or even GBH. The judge directs the jury. There doesn't seem to have been any of this. At least I've heard nothing said about it so far.
It certainly hasn't come out in any of the reports of it that I've read.
No, I mean, even if they didn't find him guilty of murder, they should most definitely find him guilty of either manslaughter or grievous bodily harm, which can carry a sentence nearly as bad as murder.
But then it depends on what you're charged with, doesn't it? He was charged with murder, he was found not guilty of that, and you can't be tried for the same offence twice.
That's right, I believe.
So then have the prosecution screwed it up?
Yes, I believe you touched on it earlier on when you said, has there been an administration cock-up? And I do believe there has been in this case, to be quite honest, between the police and the Department of Prosecution, whoever they call it. But that guy should not be walking the streets tonight.
No, if you take the premise that people who are in prison are the one reason they're in prison is that they are a danger to society, what's this guy doing walking the streets then?
That's right. That's right. Morally, he shouldn't be walking the streets tonight. But can I broach another thing which troubles me after listening to a lot of impassioned people on your show, because I've had me pinned to this phone for a long time, is that everybody's advocating violence. I mean, where is society going? I mean, you know, is this 15 years of conservative government to end up like this? Nobody seems to have any confidence in the police or the courts. Everybody's talking about taking the law into their own hands. I think Petrina was about the only one that was controlled, because everybody else seems to be rather impassioned, and I'm trying to be controlled. But we're certainly going the wrong way. I don't know what you think about it, Ian.
It's something I've said frequently over a long period of time, that I think when it comes around to the general election, you've probably got to remember that all those years ago when the Tories came to power, they were the Law and Order Party. And I think you've got to look at their record on that, which I believe is diabolical.
Society is going the wrong way, mate, isn't it? And what worries me is, where is it all going to end, you know? Are we going to go around battening each other on the head with pickaxe handles like it's been advocated tonight, or shooting legs out, or taking the law into our own hands? Christ, the law's there to defend us, you know? I think this is where this guy went wrong with the hammer, actually. He should have rung the police and let the police handle it. Because these situations can happen in the split second, can't they?
As indeed happened with this?
Oh, certainly. And he's dead. Poor man, you know? But okay. This guy should not be walking the streets.
He should be away because you reckon he's a danger?
I certainly do. By the way, if you phone me back, is it Eric? Captain Nathan?
Yes.
Give me his phone number. I'll drop him off a bottle of whiskey round tomorrow, because I think I'll live by him.
Okie dokie, I'll do that round about 2.
Yeah, great.
All right, mate.
All right, then, all the best.
Ta-ra.
Ta-ra, mate.
There we go. Eric, half a bottle of whiskey for you there, mate. We'll sort that out for you. Who is next? Dave, he's next, that's who. On this line. Morning, Dave.
Hello, morning, Ian.
Hello, thanks for hanging on.
That's okay. Right, well, this is a case full of dilemmas and contradictions, isn't it? None of which, I hasten to add, validate this Joe Elliott's actions. You know, there's no... As far as I'm concerned, I think he should have had a suspended sentence.
From the neck?
Yes. Boom, yes. Boom. Yeah, joking aside, the guy's a complete toe rag, but... you know, the question of the jury is puzzling me. On the one hand, I can understand in a way how they came about the verdict, because as Petrina so rightly said, they can only bring a verdict on the evidence that they hear. And, you know, as I say, you've only got to listen to some of the defense lawyers and things like that who twist and speak very eloquently, and no doubt can make the guy, you know, they probably, I wouldn't mind a few of them doing my CV for me, and
probably came out they couldn't work out if they were trying Joe Elliott or Mother Teresa.
Sure. But I mean, I think here we've got the reaction that this guy did was one which I think, you know, I can see. Well, in fact, I know that I've done myself, not quite with the same consequences, but I actually caught somebody driving away. I came out of the post office with my tax disc in my hand and saw somebody driving off in my car. And believe it or not, a classic line, I hailed a taxi that was going behind and said, follow that car.
I've always wanted to do that.
And when we got down to some traffic lights, and the guy must have done a right again, and he was sort of like the opposite way, and the cab pulled up and the guy said to me, don't get out, but of course it just took over, and we're talking about the reaction, and I was out and chasing after this guy, and he knew, I mean, fortunately for him, the lights changed. I stood there as the car went past me, and it was dumped about 5 minutes later, and I got it back about 3 days later. I hadn't gone anywhere, but I can understand the reaction, and I think this is probably what's happened with this guy. He's probably out because, again, a lot of the facts of the case, and I'm only saying what I've heard on the news, so I can't claim to have actually sort of been there reporting or anything like that, but it appears that the fella, this sorry, I forgot his name now, is it Robert Osborne,
yeah.
He's out. Apparently this vandalism had gone on before. Now you can fully understand, can't you? He hears the sound of hissing air coming out of his tyres. He gets really, you know, really angry about this and thinks, here we go again. And apparently he chased this guy back to the flats, a distance of some 400 yards. Now, apparently, and again, according to newspaper reports, you're right, you know, the guy's up on the landing, being all brave, etc., you know, if you want me, come and get me. And I can imagine that this Robert Osborne had a rush of blood to the head, chased after him. So he took a hammer, but I mean, you know...
But you up the ante as soon as you arm yourself, don't you?
You do, but isn't... You know, I tend to sort of... I mean, you know, there, but for the grace of God, go I. I mean, that would have been me. That would have been my reaction as well. Because
I've been in a similar situation myself. I honestly, just on a personal note, I'm going to have to wind this up because I've still got a lot of calls to get through.
Right.
But I can't see that justice was done.
No, justice wasn't done. Absolutely. The guy should be, this Joe Elliott guy should be hanging, swinging for the end of a rope now. He killed a man, and how they can come up with a thing of self-defense is beyond me, because killing somebody is not reasonable force against what wasn't a hammer. It was a wooden mallet, whatever that may be. But I can't imagine for 1 minute that murder would justify, you know, a plea of self-defense, because it just doesn't. It's patent nonsense.
Okie dokie, thanks for that.
That's okay, mate.
Ta-ra.
Bye-bye now.
We got Darren. We'll get everybody in, I hope. Darren, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. What are your views?
Well, this is a very emotive subject, but one thing I've asked myself, now, I believe the guy got stabbed in the heart, yes?
Yes, he did.
Good aim by the guy who had the knife.
Sorry?
Go for the heart. I mean, like, you know, we're going to cause a bit of serious bit of damage by stabbing the guy in the heart, aren't you?
Well, you're going to kill him.
Exactly. I mean, was he after injuring him, or was he after killing him?
Which goes back to reasonable force, doesn't it?
I mean, personally speaking, I mean, if you see the guy that died, now, he's gone out there, he's up the ante by taking the hammer, so, you know, he's asking for trouble doing that. And he's gone out there, and this guy's pulled a knife and stabbed him. And if you ask this guy now, if you could get in contact with his dad and said, look, you know, how do you feel about it? He'd probably say, well, I'm not, they'd be worried, but, you know, okay, I've suffered the consequences of my actions. but this guy's got off scot-free. I mean, Christ, you know, where's the justice in that? There isn't any.
You said it. Thanks for hanging on. I've got to rush through these because I want to get as many people in as I can. Mike.
Hi.
Hello, Mike. What are your views?
I'm going to switch it slightly. I've done jury service twice. Now, on a case like this, it's very difficult when you're looking at people's family and you feel intimidated by them because you're looking straight at them as well.
So if a jury gets intimidated, as you're suggesting, is the jury system the right system?
Well, no, I think the new thing they're going to bring in and lessen the jury system and let the judge decide.
And that would be more effective, you believe?
On certain cases.
Okie dokie, sorry to keep it short, but I want to get everybody in. Next, we've got Simon. Good morning, Simon.
Ian, I can sympathise totally with this guy. The reason being, I've been in a similar situation myself. I was asleep in bed at 3 o'clock in the morning, and I was this guy smashed his way into my house, dragged me out of bed, threatened to kill me. I didn't put up a fight at all. He, you know, continued smashing me on the head. It wasn't until my neighbours called out the police that he was managed to stop and was arrested. Hello?
Hello, I tell you what, this sounds like it's going to need more time than we've got. So can you just hang on the line?
Okay.
All right, you hang on there, and we'll give the last say of the night to Matt. Good morning, Matt.
Hi. I think the jury came out with the right answer.
Why?
Osborne, he wasn't defending his property. The guy wasn't on his property, the guy had run away, he was 400 yards from his house. He'd gone after him with a hammer. He was after more, I wouldn't say revenge, I think he was doing what was in himself, what was right, but he wasn't defending his property.
He was reacting?
Yes.
Was he trying to start something then?
The lad gave him a challenge and he went up the stairs, up the flat, didn't he? So, he didn't go up to just defend his property, is what I'm saying.
Okie dokie, sorry to cut you short. Is that a Merseyside accent, is it?
Originally.
Whereabouts?
Wallasey.
Oh, Birkenhead.
No, Wallasey.
Well, close enough. My own home.
In between.
My own dear hometown. Thanks for that, Matt.
All right, ta-ra.
Ta-ra. Thanks for all your calls. Sorry if we couldn't get you on. It was real busy again. Beacon Radio
News. The 2 o'clock news. This is Sarah Lockett. John Major will be celebrating this morning after seeing off a challenge to his authority over the Maastricht Treaty. The House of Lords voted by a majority of 269 to reject Baroness Thatcher's call for a referendum on closer European ties. The leader of the Lords, Lord Wakeham, says the treaty is now on course for ratification.
The majority was higher than I thought it was going to be, and indeed the turnout was higher. It is the highest turnout of voters in the House of Lords ever. It's a good result and good for the government, and I hope it means that we can now deal with the remaining stages of the ratification process and put that behind us and get on and do some more constructive things.
A man is still being held by police after being arrested at allegedly carrying a bomb in North London. He'd been under surveillance for some time. Police say the bomb was in a hold all ready to be primed. 7 people are also being held in Scotland under the Prevention of Terrorism Act after raids in Stirling. Anti-war campaigners have been ejected from the public gallery in the Commons after demanding the withdrawal of American troops from Somalia. Paul Rowley reports.
The demonstration came as Labour's Overseas Development spokesman Michael Meacher was speaking.
In debt for every man, woman and child in that country.
4 men and a woman climbed over seats at the back of the gallery, draping a banner above the chamber. They branded American troops as murderers before being led away. A further 70 protesters then mounted a sit-in in the nearby central lobby, but left after a short time. Paul Rowley, IRN Westminster.
2 of Britain's poorer regions are a step closer to getting £2 million worth of EC grants. The European Parliament has added Merseyside and the Highlands and Islands to its list of areas qualifying for aid. Merseyside would get £1 billion over 6 years and the Scottish region £300 million. A father and son have died after being hit by a train in Kent. 46-year-old Michael Whiting and his son Peter, who was 23, were working on cables near the line at Faversham. British Transport Police has launched an investigation. Independent Radio News.
The latest satellite picture is produced by John Warner from orbital station Meteosat 4. The most accurate forecast.
Heavy rain spreading into our area from the southwest overnight. The pollen count's low, expected to stay that way. Rain will spread into all areas this morning. It's going to turn to drizzle by midday. Then more rain back with us in the evening. Winds will become fresh. Top temperature 19 Celsius, 66 degrees Fahrenheit. The outlook Friday, sunny intervals with occasional showers. Saturday, mostly dry with above average temperatures. Rain on Sunday, though. Temperature now 13 Celsius, 55 degrees Fahrenheit. No Nonsense Mindless Boogie starting the hits and headlines 2 at 2 on Beacon and WABC. Status Quo and Paper Play, music to play your imaginary guitar to. All you got to do is tell me which years we're featuring. One from the 70s, one from the 80s, and those years, 7. Count them, mother, 7 years apart this morning. What we'll do is we'll get everybody who gets the years right, put them in a draw, do that in around about an hour's time. First one out of the draw can become a shoplifter at Ian and Al's shopping mall, because outside the store, just there, in a very carelessly placed position, we have a Jack Daniels t-shirt, a large size Jack Daniels t-shirt, and I'll put it there, and I really don't think it should be there, because somebody could easily just walk past the shop and steal it. So that's what we got this out, a Jack Daniels t-shirt for you to steal. If you're the first one out the draw, you're the shoplifter. If you're second person out the draw, we'll give you 10 creds. Save your creds. As soon as you've got enough credits, you come into Ian and Al's shopping mall, and you buy whatever it is you want to buy. That's fair enough, isn't it? As long as we've got it in stock and you've got enough credits, you can scoop the loot. But I don't like the look of that Jack Daniels t-shirt just outside the shop door there, because I've just got this horrible feeling that somebody is going to steal it. And we'll find out who the shoplifter is in round about an hour's time. I don't know. Encouraging shoplifting. I'm not entirely sure that is the function of independent local radio, but there you go. So, year from the 70s, year from the 80s, 7 years apart this morning. In our featured 1980s year, the big news of the year was that, you know, basically, John Lennon was shot dead in New York City on December the 8th.
It's not too important for you to know my name, nor I to know yours, or is it we communicate, but to me
Deborah Harry and Blondie on Beacon and WABC's Midnight Line. That was... which one is a play? I can't remember. Oh, yes, I do. Of course I do. Tidy's High and Nobody Told the Drug Squad. OK, it's the Midnight Line. And we're talking about rape this morning and whether or not we felt that a six-year sentence passed on a convicted rapist was adequate. The victim's mother says it wasn't. We're talking about that. We're talking about all elements of rape. We've had some very brave ladies indeed phone up and tell us about their experiences and what they went through. And after listening to them, it puts the 6 years right into context as being absolutely nothing for the weight of offence that's committed. That's just my personal opinion. Let's find out what Vera's got to say. Good morning, Vera.
Morning, Ian.
Good morning.
I liked that song. It was nice.
Thank you.
Well, there's one or two points I'd like to make this evening. The first is, if Eric took all his clothes off, or for that matter, if you took all your clothes off, I wonder how many women would leap on you and have their wicked way.
Very few, I would reckon, if any.
Well, you know, his little comments about naughty ladies showing their thighs in public were, I thought, bad taste, to say the least of it. A woman should be able to wear exactly what she chooses, including nothing, and still say no.
But the courts are peppered, aren't they, with judges' snidey little comments about you asked for it. I mean, why was it an 11-year-old was told she was no angel?
Yeah, well, I think the woman...
So it's an attitude that permeates the judicial system, isn't it?
Yeah, I think they ought to leap on every man in sight and give him a good grope and say, well, you've asked for it, you crossed your legs, you dirty devil. Anyway, that wasn't the reason.
I agree with you totally. You should be able to wear exactly what you want.
Absolutely.
When you want.
Absolutely. And we know judges are, you know, pretty crappy, aren't they?
Just a lot.
Just a lot, yeah. But there was a little point I was musing over, which I thought might be an idea. I know it's not a solution. There isn't a solution to criminal activities. I don't think there's anything we can do about them. I think there'll always be somebody who's going to go out and do something horrible, rotten and miserable and mean to someone else. And while there are those people, we've got to have suitable punishments. But it seems to me the women that have spoken tonight, and I thought very eloquently, particularly Mel, and thank God that times have changed due to women campaigning and the police becoming aware of a different attitude being necessary. And I hope I'm making sense.
I'd agree with you that attitudes have changed, but only slowly.
Well, yes, but they have changed, and I think they are at a point now which is much more conducive to justice.
And I think once this generation of judges pop the clogs...
Well, I don't know, you'll get another lot of old farts coming on then.
Well, apparently not, because they're expanding the judicial service to... What they're actually going to start doing is advertising judges' jobs.
Oh, we should get some of the rapists applying then, you know, and they'll...
Well, I actually did think of putting him myself, honestly.
I'd make a good judge. You'd definitely make a good judge. You're terribly impartial. Hang them all, you say.
That's it.
Cut their undercarriages off.
Absolutely. Nobody could accuse me of being biased.
Well, it wouldn't help, but...
But would it make people feel better?
Well, I was wondering about how we could make the victims feel better.
That's what I meant.
You know, well, for instance, I mean, if a man were a convicted rapist, and I'm talking about convicted, don't you think it would be a good idea if he were made to pay part of his income as compensation to his victim for the rest of his life?
Not a bad idea.
Well, she's going to feel, you know, 20 years on, hell, that bugger's still suffering in the same way that I am.
But then you've got to make absolutely sure, haven't you?
But you have. If you're going to hang someone, I mean, or knock them out of a plane or something.
Yeah, I was being reasonably flippant. It would have sort of solved the problem.
But I mean,
realistically, you can't do it.
Money's not going to rob someone of their life or their family jewels.
But then there was a situation just before last Christmas where a bulimic girl, a teacher, went missing. She claimed she'd been abducted and raped. It turned out that she was actually bulimic. and she just couldn't face Christmas. Now, that's only one step away, isn't it, from disappearing, crying rape. You're only one step away from saying, and he did it.
Well, I'm assuming that you're only going to do this to people who are found guilty, and mistakes are made, you might say. But when you're taking money from someone, you're not withdrawing anything that important from them. It will be important to them, but it would mean that those people who were convicted of rape would have to remember that crime for the rest of their life, because they'd be forking out something to help their victim, and God knows it's not going to make them feel a lot better. They may not want the money, in which case they should have to fork the same amount out to something like a battered wives hostel or a children's charity. Anything, so that they know every week when they get their income that 25% of it is going to compensate for a crime that they've committed, which is not tolerated by society.
Is that one point we're missing then in the judicial system as a whole, to make people financially responsible
for crimes? Yeah, we don't hit their pockets. I mean, if a man stole your car and then had to pay you 10% of his income, well, for the next 10 years, say, in recompense for the worry you've had and the inconvenience, mind you, it'd be your motorbike, wouldn't it?
Yes.
I have gathered that you do have a little...
Did I tell you about that, did I?
Well, I don't know, I heard it somewhere. Somebody said you cut a fine figure.
On a Triumph 900 Trident?
Yes, I did hear.
That was the one.
Yes, that's the one. I'm still waiting to find out what you did to that man who spat at you.
Same as he did to me.
See, I do listen to the programme, even when I don't phone up and gobble.
Yeah, exactly the same as he did to me.
Did you really?
Yeah, I chased after him on my bike.
I had a better one when I was living in Germany about spitting. You know, we were stationed in Germany, my husband was in the army, and the people in the part of Germany that we lived didn't like the British. Don't know why, just because we beat them in a little fight. Anyway, they didn't, and this is some time ago. And all the wives used to go to the local zoo, and there was one particular keeper there who had a guinea pig village, you know? Well, I know you don't have them here.
A village of guinea pigs.
He had this great village of guinea pigs, nice little things. Anyway, whenever he heard two English wives talking, he would spit at them. And we found it pretty nasty and offensive. And none of us could think what to do, because none of us could bring ourselves to spit back at him. Anyway, we were leaving to come home back to England from Germany, and I had a collection of 24 guinea pigs in my garden. So I went with my shopping trolley with all my guinea pigs in it and inserted them into his guinea pig farm. And they were a different breed from his, and they messed all his guinea pigs up because they mated. And it was all in the newspapers and everything, and this poor man was standing there scratching his head, wondering why his smooth-haired guinea pigs had suddenly gone curly with long hair.
Start to look a bit like Rod Stewart.
Yeah, it was great.
You don't mess with Vera.
No, don't mess with me. I've got my shopping trolley. I can travel.
The other consideration, I mean, financial hit them where it hurts in the pocket is, what happens if somebody's on income support?
Well, so he's still getting an income.
Yeah,
it may be peanuts, but pinch one of his peanuts.
But public, or both of them, like I've been suggesting all night, public scorn is quite an effective weapon, isn't it? I mean,
I suppose you could tattoo them on the forehead, convicted of rape.
Because you don't know, do you? If you walk down the road, you could pass a rapist and you wouldn't know.
Well, yeah.
What would you do if you passed a known convicted rapist? Would you just walk past?
Well, at my age and with my looks, I'd probably stop and say, are you on a night off or can I bother you?
Give him his own
medicine.
That is
a joke.
Yes, okay.
That is a joke.
Tasteless, but a joke.
Yeah, well, you know, you listen to Eric's tasteless
joke. True, there is that.
You can well listen to mine.
There is that.
No, I mean, I can't see that there's any way that you could do that. I mean, you can't mark someone for life, can you?
Why not? The rapists mark the victims.
Yes, but it's an internal scar. Yes, and I think that's true, that they are marked for life. But I think it would mark a man more if he knew that he was going to have to pay for his, and I mean in cash, because it's going to ruin his life in the same way that he's ruined the woman's life.
Okie dokie, listen, we're going to move on, Vera.
Yes, do.
All right, thanks for your call.
Okay, bye.
Ta-ra. We got Danny next, and then we've got Vicky, Claire and Phil. Danny's on this line. Morning, Danny.
Morning.
Morning. Now, I believe you've been up to things today.
Yeah.
What
yeah.
happened?
Well, what happened, my daughter, she's 15, was harassed, sexually harassed by somebody near to where we live.
So you know who?
We know who he is. I told somebody off air exactly what I did to the guy. I hospitalised him.
So you took the law into your own hands?
Well, I took the law into my own hands, yeah. The guy's got 3 broken ribs, facial injuries. The police have been involved, and virtually what they're trying to say to me is that that they will press charges, but if they do, they're going to charge me with wounding.
Malicious wounding?
Yep. And to me...
What were your alternatives? I mean, you must have lost your temper. Anybody would lose their
temper.
Well,
put it this way, right, as far as I'm concerned, right, what I've done today is what any decent father would do. I meant to say, right, my daughter, she's only 15, right? I meant to say, even now she's upset about it, you know?
What did the police say you should have done?
Well, you know, the usual thing, like...
you should have called them.
You should have called them, like, but, you know what I mean? I lost my head, like, and as I said, like, to me, right, what I did, right, a lot of people might not agree with me, but, you know, me personally, I think what I did, I was justified to do it.
See, because I can look at it impartially, I would say that one side of me says, oh, well, you acted as judge, jury and executioner. The other side of me, which doesn't want to look at it impartially, says it's absolutely nothing I wouldn't have done, probably.
Yeah.
But I still don't think it's right to do. It's a strange thing. I understand why you did it.
Yeah.
Because, as you say, I think any father would.
Yeah. And, like, the thing about it now, right, that guy, I mean to say, the guy lives about 100 metres from where we live, right? And we've got to walk down that road every single day. Right, and, you know what I mean? What's stopping him doing it again? Or what's stopping him doing it to... what's stopping him going even further?
Well, are the police going to consider action against him?
Nothing at all.
Did they say why not?
Because, well, more or less, what they've told me is that he's had a good hiding off me, and I think that is enough. That will teach him a lesson, and I should leave it like that. So what I'm going to do tomorrow is see my solicitor and see if I can do something about it. But they're trying to tell me, right, that if I do come up to the police station and say that I want to press charges, they'll arrest me there and then and charge me with a Section 18.
So basically they're telling you now to forget it?
Yeah, correct.
But then is that fair? Because you took the law into your own hands, you administered your own justice.
Yeah. I know, but...
And they're saying, okay, fair enough, we understand why...
But that was for my satisfaction, right? That was for me, right? I mean, I've given a beating, right? And the way I feel now, right? I hope it has worked, right? But the way I see it now, when he sees another young lady walking down the road, he'll think twice.
I think he probably will. Danny, I'll tell you what I want you to do.
Yeah.
When you've had time to think about it and so forth, I want you to give us a call on Friday.
Yeah.
And let us know what the outcome was.
Okay.
All right, Danny?
All right, then.
Ta-ra.
Cheers.
There we go. Danny taking the law into his own hands. Police have sort of gone down the middle on that one, allegedly, from what I can see. It's not right. You can never say it's right to take the law into your own hands, but at the same time, anybody with half an ounce of sense... you can see why he did what he did. Okay, we got Vicky next. Vicky's on this line here. Morning, Vicky.
Morning.
Good morning. Are you a first-time caller, eh?
Yes, I am.
Ooh. I wouldn't worry about it. Not worth worrying about, Vicky. Life's too short.
Yeah.
Vicky, you've heard what everybody else has said. What's your opinion?
Well, I mean, I'm a victim myself. I was actually 9.
9.
Yeah. And I knew the guy. He was a very good friend of my dad's. And he was babysitting at the time. And it took me 2 years to tell somebody.
Did you realise what was happening?
Well, sort of, because, I mean, the other bad thing was, my sister, my older sister, who was 12, helped him do it.
Why did your older sister help?
Well, she'd already been with him herself, but willingly. And this one day, first of all, he was just mucking about. And then he just turned vicious, really.
And I presume that your elder sister had sort of obviously kept it from your parents?
Well, I was just living it with my father.
Well, kept it from your father, then?
Yeah.
So he didn't know what was going on?
No.
Took you 2 years to tell somebody?
Yeah.
Did you realise it was wrong when it was happening? Because at 9, I would imagine it's very difficult.
Yeah.
You don't really know, do you? Because life's full of new experiences, and you wouldn't, I don't think, automatically know that this was the wrong thing to do, or that he shouldn't be doing this to you.
Well, I mean, I can't really exactly say whether I knew it was wrong at the time, because I didn't really know.
Who did you tell, eventually?
Well, I was actually taken into care shortly afterwards through family problems, and when I was 11... my foster mother sort of like really brought it out in me, because she told me that when I'd first moved in with her, she knew something was wrong because I wouldn't go near my foster dad. And then I eventually told her one day. And then she got in touch with the police and they interviewed me. And then we were told that he was well known for it, but he never got charged or nothing. And they'd been after him for years for raping young girls.
And you were 11 by now, were you?
Yeah. They interviewed my sister, who was 12, and she denied it all. So they said they couldn't do nothing because I was under 10.
So you, effectively, weren't protected from him?
Pardon?
You, effectively, had no protection?
No.
No, but nobody was looking out for you?
No.
Because you were under 10 and because they couldn't get everybody telling the same story, that was it. You were not taking it any further.
That's it. And he's still walking about. And he always has been. Because I did actually see him 4 years later. Because I went back to live with my mum. And he worked in a garage, which he still does. And we pulled in for some petrol and there he was. And I just froze.
So he's still knocking around, nobody's done anything to him?
Nope. I mean, occasionally I still see him about, if I'm in a certain area.
Does it still affect your day-to-day life?
Well, not as bad as it did. I mean, when I was 16, my mum was remarried and she had a little baby. And I started thinking to myself, hopefully I'll have one myself one day. And I never thought I would, but I have now.
So you managed to sort of to resume a normal life?
Just about.
How old are you now?
I'm 19 now.
So it's taken you 10 years?
Yeah. But it's still there, and always will be.
What do you think should happen to people like that?
Well, I think that they should be made to suffer like the victims have. In a different way, of course, but there should be a way.
But give them a sentence that they'll carry around for the rest of their life.
Yeah.
Sounds fair enough. I've got to move on, I'm afraid, Vicky, but thanks a lot for being brave enough to talk about it.
Yeah, it's just one other thing.
Yeah.
Because I'm married as well, you see. But my husband has asked me to ask you if there'd be any chance that he could have a signed photograph of you.
Your husband?
Yeah.
Do you want to talk about this? I'll tell you what, if you hang on, Vicky.
Yeah.
You hang on there, and James, the lovely James, has been answering the phone tonight. Thanks for that, James. If you could take Vicky's address, that'd be jolly good. We got Claire next. Good morning, Claire.
Hi.
Hello. Hi. We'll just pump you up a bit, because you're a bit quiet. There you go. Claire. We just spoke to Vicky. We spoke to a lot of women tonight who've been abused, have been victims of sex attacks. I believe you have as well.
Yes, I have. It was 12 years ago now. I was only 16 at the time, 16 and a half, and I was a virgin. It was at a fairground, but it wasn't just a single rape. It was a gangbang rape. None of them were white. I am. It has now turned me very prejudiced against coloureds.
Despite the fact you realise that not everybody's like that?
Yes. Yes, I mean, it can happen from a white man, it can happen from a black man. I feel very strongly about rape. I was, like the girl who was on before Eric, I came in at that point from work, and she feared going to the police. I did too. I mean, my parents don't even know about it now.
So, nobody knows about it?
Well, my boyfriend did. He didn't like it.
Do you understand that?
I do, but he went on to marry me and I divorced him because even though I had two children by him, but sex didn't feel right.
And you put it down to that one incident?
It wasn't one incident, it was 15. It was 15 in one night.
Surely after that, why didn't you go to the police?
I was too frightened, I was threatened. I still see these men in town, like Vicky does.
And again?
And I fear, when I see them, I freeze. My marriage broke up purely because I can't relax in sex.
Have you ever talked to anybody about it?
Yes, my doctor.
And what's your doctor said?
Well, not a great deal. Try and get over it.
Terrific. It's like pointing to Everest, isn't it? It's like
trying
to climb it.
Well, yeah, there's the peak, yeah.
Go up there. So you've effectively had no support apart from your ex-husband?
No, I haven't. My boyfriend now supports me. He knows about it.
And you still have to live with it even if it's just a simple thing like going to the shops?
Yes, I do. Because I can identify these men. I worked with a girl who brought photographs into work from a christening. And here comes one of these men who pops up with his wife and child. And she says, oh, he's a lovely man. And I'm thinking, God, he's raped me, you know?
And yet he just blends back.
Yeah. He looks such a lovely man, but God, she doesn't know what he's done. Does she know his past? I can't tell him. And I can't tell her. I can't tell the police because I'm afraid.
And it seems from what we've talked about tonight and from a lot of the ladies we talked to, that even if justice takes its course, ultimately justice ends in the courts, and we've heard of 2 one-year sentences, 1 six-year sentence.
Well, that's pathetic, because it doesn't end at 1 year or 2 years. It lives with a woman for the rest of her life.
So would it be fair then to introduce sentences, as I've suggested, for rapists that live with them for the rest of their life?
Yes, yes, certainly. Because I think rapists should be identified. If a woman can actually go into court and stand up and say, he has raped me, and prove it.
Then they shouldn't be able to just serve a derisory sentence and then just blend back into the wife
and
kids scenario.
No, why? Why should they? Because a woman is a victim, and she will always feel victimised.
I agree with you completely, Claire. I agree with you completely. I'm going to have to leave it there because we've got to go up to the news in a moment. I've still got a couple of more calls to get in, but thanks for talking to us.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Who have we got next? We've got Phil. Hello, Phil.
Sterling.
Sterling.
Yeah.
All right, Sterling.
Fine. I just wanted to point out that it's not only women that get raped, because I was raped as well when I was 7 and again when I was 17.
Do you know who by?
Yeah. It wasn't the same person, it was 2 different people. I don't see the one when I was 7, but I still see the one who raped me when I was 17.
Do you share the same feelings that the girls you've been on tonight have felt?
Well, I think that people who rape, they should be raped themselves, and they feel how it is to be violated. Because, I mean, I'm gay myself, but, I mean, it's taken me a hell of a long time to be able to have any kind of relationship, because I just didn't trust anybody at all.
So despite a difference in gender, the effects of rape are the same?
I think they're the same, but in other ways they're different, because for men, the way society is today, they can't go to someone and say, I've been raped, because they're not going to be believed. And so, also in the law says that men cannot be raped, which is crap, because they can.
So then men are suffering what women suffered 30 years ago, aren't they?
Mm-hmm. And it's not just, I mean, there are quite a few men, because I know at least three besides me.
I'll tell you what, you just hang on there. We've got to take the news. Thanks for all your calls tonight.
The 2 o'clock news. This is Sarah Lockett. Labour's legal spokesman is calling on the Attorney General to look at the case of a vandal who was freed for killing a neighbour. 19-year-old Joseph Elliott from South London stabbed Bob Osborne to death after he was caught slashing car tyres. Elliott pleaded self-defence at the Old Bailey yesterday. Both men were constituents of Labour MP John Fraser, who says the verdict's very disturbing.
It must raise very seriously the cause for concern about how self-defence works, how trials like this appear to work. Nothing more can be done in this case. That's the golden rule, that if somebody's acquitted by a jury, that is that, and we'd be very dangerous ground if we went back on those things.
The UN may have to withdraw from Bosnia as funds to run the relief effort rapidly run out. Chief UN mediator Thorvald Stoltenberg has briefed the Security Council on the dire shortage of relief supplies. The UN operation in Somalia is also in danger after fierce criticism of the American strike on Mogadishu. Baroness Thatcher will today vote against the Tories for the first time in her 34-year parliamentary career. The former Prime Minister will lead an all-party campaign in the House of Lords for a referendum on the Maastricht Treaty. From Westminster, Paul Rowley.
The government is decidedly nervous about the occasion. Baroness Thatcher's former Deputy Lord Howe says she's undermining her successor.
If it were to win, it would commit us to an internecine feud for months ahead, with Conservatives pitted against Conservatives. It would certainly do no good to John Major's position as Prime Minister.
The pro-referendum Tory Lord Pearson says it's a matter of principle.
One has to choose between loyalty to the Constitution as we've known it and loyalty indeed to the British people.
Nonetheless, despite both camps recruiting a large number of backwoodsmen who rarely attend, the government believes it'll win the vote. Paul Rowley, IRN Westminster.
Scientists have discovered a possible dinosaur nesting area and an egg which has survived 145 million years intact. A dark patch inside one broken egg could be the remains of an embryo. Paleontologists in Denver say the find from the Jurassic period is very important. Independent Radio News.
The latest satellite picture is produced by John Warner from orbital station Meteosat 4. The most accurate forecast.
Big question is, do you boil it or fry it? Overnight low 11 Celsius, 52 degrees Fahrenheit. It's going to remain mild through the night and drizzly, I'm afraid. Pollen count's low. It's expected to stay that way. We're the first with the pollen count from 6 o'clock every morning. Later today, mostly dry with a lot of cloud and just a few sunny intervals. Rain spreading from the southwest in the evening. Maximum temperature 20 Celsius, 68 degrees Fahrenheit. Piece of advice, if you're ever going to read weather, don't try and bolt your coffee shortly before you do it. The outlook, occasional rain on Thursday and Friday and rather warm. Temperature now 11 Celsius, 52 degrees Fahrenheit.